Chapter 3. Verdant Unknown.
Our visor fogs up with humidity as we descend the mechanical elevator shaft and emerge into a surprising vegetated overgrowth. This subterranean jungle has its walls completely shrouded in thick, thorny vines, and its mossy platforms jutting out from the dense forest are coated in unusual biological structures similar to wasp nests formed out of dried seaweed. Tiny specks of blue light seep in through the rare holes in the canopy, feeding this natural underground greenhouse. Crawling up the walls and platforms are strange, buggy-eyed crabs called Zilas, which functionally act like gamers, but take more damage to kill. We also encounter our first Red Ripper, creatively named a Ripper 2. I wish I were kidding. For now, they're identical to past Rippers, so we ignore the enemies and drop to our first set of doors. Both to our left and to our right are red doors. Let's go for the right door first. Inside, we see an upper and lower level to this hallway. Immediately, we are attacked by a new enemy emerging from what can only be described as a Super Mario-style green warp pipe. This flying little red beetle is a Zeb, which will emerge from its nest, align itself with Samus's elevation, and fly straight at her in hopes of driving her away. Using their tactics against them, we can take advantage of this to shoot them head-on so we can safely grab their dropped pickups. However, once we do, another Zeb will quickly take its place, endlessly attacking us until we leave their territory. This is a great spot to farm for health or missiles if the need ever arises. Anyway, the backdrop to this particular room is fascinating. We see a gross blue fungus has covered the walls, and bloated bush-like organisms grow on the ground, resembling microscopic viruses more than anything else we have on Earth, with odd tentacles reaching up to gather nutrients or snag prey. Jumping up on the platform, we can run as fast as we can, but a metal blockade will descend before we can reach it, forcing us to fall through the trap pitfall blocks below. At least there's a missile expansion laying here, rewarding us for trying. Though we can't progress through this room without utilizing some unintended trickery, we can at least get a glimpse of another new enemy leaping on the ground in the next segment over past the blockade. These are sidehoppers, and fortunately they can't reach us from where we stand. Using our morph ball bombs, we can blast our way backwards and escape this room, keeping it in mind for later. Back in the main room, we can try the other red door, and once we do, we're in for a strange surprise. We are in a mechanical chamber with a sidehopper jumping on the ceiling towards us, which is apparently something they can do. Ignoring their questionable biology, this erratic enemy goes down in a few shots, and just past it we run into a couple Zilas in what appears to be a dead end. Not trusting it, we bomb the floor, revealing a hidden passageway leading us to a blue door in a small enclosed space where a single Zila crawls around. Inside the hidden room is another map station, providing us with our first look at the layout of Brinstar. Since these incomplete maps we gather from these locations tend to hide secret rooms, this better helps us understand where the critical path lies. Aside from revealing an unusual hallway far below us, we don't see any way to access. We can now see that when we took the other elevator from Crateria, we were actually entering Brinstar with our path revealed on the map to the distant east. Looking at the room we just attempted to run through makes it clear that there is indeed another item located at the end of it, a good thing to remember. We can also see that a save room is just below us. However, while trying to backtrack out of the room prior, we realize the doors are locked until we defeat all enemies. Taking them out and dropping below, we see the save room is blocked by a red door as well, but we blast it open, hop inside, and save our progress. Dropping down even further brings us to another fork in the road, with two more red doors. Good thing we've been collecting expansions, or else we'd have to be farming enemies just to open all these doors. Let's try the left first. Inside, we discover the background is dimming in and out inside of this cave, where new enemies called fire fleas buzz around in slow repeating patterns. Down below us, we can see small platforms leading us forward above a dangerous spiky overgrowth draping across the floor. If we shoot a fire flea, the room itself darkens a little, and we suddenly realize the predicament we just stepped into. We need to carefully jump from one platform to another, working our way to the left without so much as bumping into any of these fire fleas, as they are the sole source of illumination in this room. To avoid making these tricky jumps in near jet black conditions, we carefully make our way to to the blue door on the bottom left, opening out into what first appears to be a map room, but with a different device in the center. Interacting with it will refill our missiles, which we should have inferred by the red missile icon the device displays. Unfortunately, there is nothing else down this path, so we need to carefully make our way back to the previous fork, dodging the fire fleas along the way. But instead of shooting the last red door immediately, you might have noticed a Zila crawling below the floor, which looks suspiciously thin, being only one tile wide. Dropping some bombs reveals that the floor is indeed destructible, but not with our current weaponry. The blocks change into a gray square, depicting a symbol for a weapon we don't yet have. A great discovery for later once we do have this item. Shooting the last red door leads us into a squishy pink and dark blue room covered with an unearthly fungal slime, where white flakes slowly flutter to the ground behind us as if the walls themselves were shedding. It appears that we've just entered a massive nest filled with egg sacs of various sizes stuck to the walls and dripping from the ceiling. A pair of Zila and three Rios greet us as we invade the strange room and progress to the suspicious blockade at the far end. Bombing our way through, we find the cavern continues with strange blocks on the floor amidst the slime. Bombing them reveals yet another gray square and a symbol we don't recognize. The game knows by now that we've effectively passed its tutorial training grounds on open world exploration and in finding our own path forward with the abilities we acquire. Now things have gotten even more complicated with a series of blockades we don't even understand. Moving down the cave further, the passageway narrows before opening back up under the watchful eyes of three menacing metaries. These scree relatives are coated in thick metal plating and are invulnerable to our known weaponry, and just like their cousins, will dive bomb passersby with a self-destructive attack, exploding into shrapnel. Just as bees will give their lives to sting and ward off threats to their hive, screes and their relatives are proving to be more and more dangerous, especially when perched in narrow caves like this one. Interestingly enough, there are unique mounds of golden lumps in the background below where the metaries hung. We won't find these peculiar mounds anywhere else and are likely the droppings from the metaries, fat from the many unsuspecting life forms that didn't make it past this point. Gross. Passing the blue door at the end of the tunnel, we emerge into a huge open space. Before we climb upwards, let's head down towards the strange new blocks lining the ceiling below, another new type of block we can't interact with. But by investigating too closely, we fall into a trap, dropping us into a wide open space with two angry side hoppers. We rush to escape but find we can't make the jump back out and choose to either fight or keep checking the area. On the far left, we drop through a set of pitfall blocks, plunging us into a corridor with two Rio diving right for us. Finding our composure after dealing with the swarming insects, we find a new door type right in front of us, and it's yellow. Even though several of the blockades we've discovered so far in Brinstar are secretly overcome by the same power-ups, this is the game testing our memory and attempting to overwhelm us. And if it's your first time, it's probably working. Well, we've fallen this far, so let's keep spelunking downwards past a Zeb pipe and a Rio. Falling to the left drops us right next to a welcome missile expansion in the corner. Moving to the right, we find a very narrow tunnel through the pink slime and some odd blocks sticking out at the bottom, teasing us to bomb them. Giving it a try reveals a hidden path leading down a steep ledge toward a hidden Chozo statue, holding a new optional upgrade, the Charge Beam. The Charge Beam allows us to literally charge our beam weapons to unleash a much stronger blast, tripling its damage. Now, if we continue bombing this hidden alcove, we will find that below the statue's pedestal, another gray block appears, requiring a future upgrade. Heading back up the cliffside, we bomb our way out and check what was past that narrow tunnel above us, only to be met by another new door color, green. Unlike the block icons we didn't recognize, at least we can identify that we will need a weapon of some sort that matches this color. With no other option, we backtrack all the way back up this large room to where we first entered it, passing the Zeb pipe on the raised platform. Climbing the east wall leads us to a narrow tunnel with two side hoppers. Emerging from the tunnel, we see a Zeb pipe to our right and a protruding ledge on the left. Bombing the left leads us to a well-earned save station. Brinstar is much more dangerous than Crateria, and we might just be approaching the epicenter of this alien nest. Passing the Zeb pipe, we find a red door and blast our way through. Immediately, we are attacked by a huge flying wasp with long stinger arms called a Kai Hunter. The instruction manual claims that the Kai Hunters are another race of space pirates from a distant galaxy, cooperating with the crustaceans we are more familiar with. In order to rebuild a base base of operations on Zebes, but it also misspells their name, so do with that information what you will. There are a total of 3 in this room, and they can easily swarm you if you are not careful. The Kai Hunter flies right at us, stabbing its long stinger arms and stays on the offensive with much more aggressive tracking than any past enemy we've encountered. After taking a couple shots, their wings disintegrate, and they unflinchingly continue to attack us, slashing and spitting acid our way until we deal the killing blow. Now, let's pause for a moment. Here's your friendly reminder that Samus Aran is 6'3" or 190 centimeters without her power suit. She's practically an Amazonian in terms of height and strength, and this massive bug that just unrelentingly attacked her was even taller than her while it was hunched over, ignoring however much extra height the power suit adds to Samus. Just imagine 3 of these colossal creatures swarming you one after another, and this is after you just explored treacherous caverns overrun with hostile alien wildlife alone. There isn't a soul on this entire planet to talk to or call for help. This is the ultimate isolation coupled with intense fear. Your fight or flight instincts mean nothing when there is nowhere to run. And still, we are here by choice. Remember that. After dealing with the Kai Hunters, the metal door on the ceiling at the end of the room unlocks. It's notably surrounded by what appear to be long gray egg sacs attached in bunches to the ceiling. The botanical life in this room is also the most floral we've seen yet in Brinstar, which is to say there are elongated red-stemmed flowers that appear to sprout unnaturally fuzzy fruit. If this place tells you anything, it's that we've reached the center point of the verdant fertility. Shooting the door and leaping through lands us in a locked enclosed space with spores slowly falling like snowflakes to the ground. Touching them causes damage, so instead we shoot them to spawn refilling pickups. But as we destroy the spores, a massive botanical thorny husk descends from the upper back wall through a thicket of greenery suspended by a string of thorny vines. To sell the effect of their elasticity, the vine is actually visualized by a series of thorned orbs that all move in unison. Ridley's tail did the same thing back on the Sarah station, giving the illusion of fluidity without overly taxing the hardware. After dodging the large and vulnerable swinging rogue husk for long enough, it will stop moving and open up its maw, revealing a set of glowing orange orbs, which are likely its eyes. Using this opportunity to strike at the horror, we fire missiles into the opening, causing it to roar in pain, close its huge husk tightly shut, and swing around the room in a figure eight pattern, flailing at us even faster as spores continue to fall. We find ourselves mostly playing defensive while avoiding its attacks and occasionally shooting floating spores to keep our health above zero. The music for this mini-boss is also notably uneasy. It's a repeating series of plucked strings, subtly numbing the background out and filling us with fear. This is far more effective than some intense boss battle music that any other game would have probably used in this situation, because instead of leading into the fact that this is a video game, it's allowing us to become invested in our personal journey and feeling the creeping emotions that Samus feels as she's trapped in this room with a giant carnivorous plant. This isn't a chaotic battle. It's a feat of survival fought deep within the lair of a horrific overgrown alien jungle, and the music and atmosphere makes us feel the weight of that fear. Now, in terms of combat, there's nothing more to the spore spawn other than repeating the same tricks. Swing wildly, peek out to see if Samus is still alive, get shot in the eye, and swing faster. It turns red slowly as it takes damage, indicating its remaining health effectively without a life bar. As far as strategy is concerned, there is a secret trick to overcoming this encounter easily. Simply go into Morph Ball in the top left corner and the spore spawn can't hit you. The falling spores also never happen to float over this tile. Granted, hiding here means you might miss your window to shoot the creature when it opens up, but only if you're not quick enough to fire off a few missiles mid-jump. It's also possible for the monstrosity to open its mouth over this spot, dealing substantial contact damage to Samus, so this can't be entirely used to assure victory. If for some reason we run out of missiles and didn't restock with the falling spores, we can also use our new charge beam to deal close to the same damage. The instruction manual reveals that this abomination was actually engineered by the space pirates. For what reason, however, is a mystery, but it implies that this whole subterranean nest of creatures was likely unnatural, and they were being cultivated for biological warfare. Eventually, the spore spawn will recoil from one final shot to the core and shrivel up into the center of the ceiling. It slowly dries up and turns brown, along with the rest of the dangerous plant life in the room. Once the creature dies completely, pickups appear over its head, indicating that it can be used as a platform. Upon jumping on top of it, we can now see the room continues above. Climbing through the shriveled vines brings us to a blue door at the top right. Entering it, we find ourselves inside more pink slime chambers with a Zeb pipe, which we can exploit to reach max health and missiles if the spore spawn drops didn't cap us already. The music has also changed to the iconic item room jingle. These intermittent beeps and boops are a genuine relief to hear for any Metroid fan, as it tends to indicate that a new upgrade is near. It was first heard in Metroid 1, simulating the ambient sounds of an abandoned self-sufficient computer room. Proceeding to the right, however, we hit a dead end, though there is a single Zeb pipe with none emerging from inside. Finding this curious, we channel our inner Italian plumber and try jumping on it, and suddenly we find ourselves dropping through a long mechanical shaft. This is a long drop. Luckily, we don't take fall damage on this planet with seemingly less gravity than Earth. Once we hit bottom, we find the item room theme did not lead us astray after all, as we fall in right in front of a Chozo statue holding a concealed item. Shooting and collecting it reveals it to be the Super Missiles. This is the Super Nintendo after all, and what better way to bring Metroid up to this 16-bit era than by making Samus's very missiles super themselves. You know they were thinking it. We can swap to these alternate missiles by cycling through the top menu with Select. Super missiles deal the damage of 3 missiles per shot, and are also strong enough to open a red door in a single crash. They're also colored green, cluing us in to aim them at the green door we found in the depths. Now that we have multiple weapons on the top screen, it's a good time to mention that by pressing Y, we can quickly deselect from the top screen to instantly stop shooting missiles, so don't feel like you have to cycle through them all each time. This menu system is surprisingly advanced, allowing active combat during menu flipping with its quick select options. Unlike many games at the time which required pausing, individually selecting the chosen item, and closing the menu every single time. With our new super missiles locked and loaded, we head to the left to escape the room. Past the door on the left, we dodge 3 Zeb pipes, ensuring we can restock our ammo. At the far left, we hit a green door. Firing one of our green super missiles at it is enough to open it up and turn it blue. It also knocks 2 hidden Zeelas from the ceiling, letting us feel the real impact of this huge concussive blast. But the game wants to make sure we understand even more versatility with super missiles before we can escape. The room following is a dead end, unless we drop some bombs to reveal a single block with a super missile icon. This should confirm player suspicion of the previous gray icon blocks being destructible with later upgrades. Firing a super missile into the block and rolling through the morph ball tunnel, we are dropped through a hidden passageway into the large room with a Ryo greeting us upon our exit. This is fortunately quite close to the green door we now know we can open. Working our way back down and through the tiny tunnel, we fire a green super missile at the door and blast it open. That was 3 we needed in quick succession, and it should be noted that like regular missiles, we start with only 5 and need expansions to increase this cap further. The next room is also large and lush with greenery. There are many colorful flowering plants below and jagged teal stalactite above as the room moves down into the right. We can see the room continues upward, but it's too high for us to make the jump. There are several pipes on the walls where we get charged by new insectoid enemies called Gigas. They fly out from pipes in the walls and try to align themselves with Samus before charging recklessly. To avoid getting smacked around as we delve deeper into the caves, now's a good time to discuss a charge beam ability I neglected to mention earlier. If we hold a full charge beam attack and spin jump, Samus will glow, indicating the full charge, and if we happen to bump an enemy during this glowing jump, they will automatically be shot with the full charge beam and killed if it's sufficient damage to defeat them. On top of this, Samus takes no damage if the shot does defeat the enemy. Taking advantage of this technique, dubbed by fans as Pseudo Screw Attack, named after the overpowered ability from past games, we can safely drop down without worrying about taking damage. Once at the bottom, a charge beam is all it takes to defeat the side hopper, and we find ourselves in front of a strange blockade with a blue button at the top. Shooting the button causes the door to raise, allowing us to keep going. 3 side hoppers are on this side of the door and must be taken out to progress safely. In the blue door at the end, we find ourselves in front of a new dangerous walking cactus enemy called a cacattack, which might just be the best named enemy in the game. Anyway, the cacattack can wander short distances, swell up, and launch thorns out in all directions at its prey. Taking them out from a distance is recommended, as the closer you get to them, the harder it becomes to dodge their needles. Just a couple shots or a charge beam will be sufficient. Now, before we progress down this new corridor, corridor, I want to call attention to something sneaky the game just did to us. Returning to the last room and attempting to backtrack reveals that the blue blockade door has sealed shut behind us. We just walked right into a trap without even realizing it. Now, there will be an ability later allowing us to open this door from the wrong side, but let's stop and think about what this actually means for the player. Functionally, all this means is that we must progress forward in order to find the means to escape back to the greater map. Having everything we've seen so far locked off from us is actually making our search easier. The game designers could have made this door slam shut behind us in an effort to scare us, as a similar door does in Hollow Knight when the player reaches the City of Tears, but that wasn't the point of this door. This door shuts so that players don't become overwhelmed with places to go. Instead, it's a gentle, albeit stern signpost telling us that we won't be returning here for a while, and there is nothing crucial for us to do beyond it for the time being. Most players won't even realize this happened, and I thought it was just too clever to pass by. Sorry, I really like this door. Anyway, back in the room with a cack attack, and yes, I will take any excuse to say cack attack again, we have a choice to make. Keep walking to the right underneath the overhead walkway, or to jump up and progress above it. Taking the above path, we won't get far before the platform erodes under our feet below some spikes on the ceiling, dropping us into the pit below with several Zealous scuttling about and another cack attack before it dead ends. This bridge exists to hammer home that we have a run button, as it will be integral to an upcoming ability. The ceiling is also lined with spikes here to discourage players from trying to jump across the disappearing blocks. As you can technically jump from these blocks the frame you touch them, but that's not the lesson of this room. With no other choice, we run over the blocks and safely reach the other side, where a third cack attack is waiting in front of a green door at the end. But once we enter it, we're surprised to step into a whole new landscape, an industrial swamp. The floral greenery is completely gone, replaced with bubbling maroon sludge. Bunches of sage green mushrooms sprout from cracks in the walls. In the background, we can see huge black metal cross braces and support beams emerging from the brown and distant purple muck, implying that this place must have been the scaffolding for some sort of industrial building, but has since been completely taken over by an out-of-control biohazard. The music has also shifted into a melancholy melody, contributing to the contemplation the strange area demands. For clarity, I'll be referring to this place as Lower Brinstar, into the vegetated domain of the spore spawn as Upper Brinstar, since they both occupy the same map regardless of their stark differences. Anyway, we find ourselves in a huge vertical shaft. Looking up, we can see a platform too high for us to reach. Thing is, there's actually a couple ways for us to get up here early. One requires a trick the game hasn't taught us yet, which we'll cover later, and another is by morph ball bomb jumping. Based on the previous layout of blocks we've had to bomb, the game knows that we know that by dropping a bomb and having it blow up on us causes our morph ball to jump. It's not far, but it still happens. Taking this one step further, we can drop bombs one after another in a precise rhythm in order to continuously jump from one bomb to another, moving straight up. You could call it a secret technique, but the game itself actually demonstrated that this was possible already. On the main menu, if we let the cinematic play out in full, the game will go into an arcade-style attract mode where it plays clips of gameplay showing off various techniques. We will discuss them all individually as we come across those power-ups later. I'm bringing up bomb jumping now because I think this room is where the game is expecting us to try it and fail. You see, we could have nabbed a couple extra power-ups by using this method, so players who took advantage of it would almost certainly try again to use it to reach this ledge early. But bombing in the middle of the platform actually destroys the center blocks. However, there is a single tile to the left of our target that we can bomb jump from. Confident that we can actually pull this off, let's try bomb jumping up to this platform. To our dismay, once we reach this point, the higher platform also breaks from morph ball bombs, leaving us nowhere to land. This is a trap to ensure that we don't try going this direction early. Instead, we drop back down, passing a couple brown gigapipes blending into the walls. Dropping lower still, the walls begin closing in on us, tightening our space. Large cracks are visible protruding from the walls as if the tips of giant screws were bolting down the massive infrastructure in the distance. We can see a yellow door to our left, but it's blocked by a wall of muck. Bombing it reveals we need another power-up to destroy it. Bombing on the right side of this enclosure, however, startles a new enemy out of hiding, and it leaps toward us like an oversized cricket. This is a B-Tom. It's invulnerable to our power beam, and once it latches onto us, it begins to slowly suck away our energy. And the way we remove them is by dropping morph ball bombs, destroying them in the process. Sounds familiar, doesn't it? Peculiar that this giant grasshopper has so many similarities with Metroids. They even sport a single colossal green eye, taking up most of their body mass, which turns red upon sucking the energy of its prey. We know that this facility is run by space pirates, and they are not above creating monstrous bioweapons like the spore spawn to achieve their goals. Could they have possibly tried and failed to engineer their own synthetic Metroids and abandoned the creatures in this foul quagmire? Through bombing the BTOM away, we've not only discovered its weakness on how to defeat them, but also the path forward. Players will almost certainly recoil from the attack and find themselves dropping bombs exactly where they need to in order to progress. Continuing to bomb down drops us into a hidden path which itself drops down to a ledge, and before we know it, we are falling a long way down past several rippers until we ultimately reach the bottom of the bog. This is another point of no return until we find a way to scale this tall scaffolding. This drop was also why the bridge back in the upper Brinstar region locked behind us, ensuring that we had no other choice but to progress by falling down this pit. In terms of game design, we feel far from home and isolated from everything we once knew, even though what we just dropped into is simply a clever way for the designers to breadcrumb us along and silently guide us to our next power-up. To our left, we have a green door with a dead-end room behind it. It is a blue version of the map and missile room design with a yellow device in the center. Interacting with it, we are relieved to have our health completely refilled. It's not a save room. We're still lost and unable to escape our predicament, but this is a welcome offering for the challenge ahead. Doubling back, we head through the blue door on our right and enter into a room partially flooded with water. Attempting to wade through it and leap to the raised metal platform, we discover that jumping in water slows us down tremendously, as it should. We can't reach this ledge unless we realize that jumping from the water is fruitless, and instead we have to stand on the muck above water near the door and make a running jump to the platform instead. Now aware of what a hazard water can be, we see another pool to our right, but this time with a pair of screes on the ceiling, spikes under the water, and only a small two-tile metal platform at water level. Without taking care of the screes first, we will almost certainly get dive-bombed and land in the spiky water, encumbered enough to then be attacked by the second scree. Jumping from the platform at water level reveals that it is not too deep to hinder our movement, so we can safely use it to reach the door on the right. Man, we can't go one room without Brinstar teaching us something new, while also making us feel like we're the ones making the discoveries firsthand. Entering the next room, we're set up against a more challenging version of the last room. The gap over the water is too far to jump, however, we do have three single-tile floating blocks to hop between. Problem is, there is a cack attack on the far platform blasting needles our way, and a new enemy perched in the water surrounded by spikes. This is a dangerous enemy called a yapping maw that doesn't outright attack us, but instead will attempt to snag us with its large mandibles and yank us toward its lair, which in this case is the thorny spikes in the water. It can be tricky to escape their traps, so these creatures are best left avoided. If they absolutely must die, then a super missile is the only way to kill them. Honestly, I thought they were indestructible before doing research for this series. So from a distance, let's take out the cack attack while carefully leaping across the platforms. Once we do, we can see a platform over our head, tempting us to check it out. Leaping above, we can see even higher still is a metallic chamber above the ceiling with a green door at its end. This would lead us to going back down to the watery muck to try and find a way up there, and by investigating the cracked block on the top left corner of the room, we can shoot an opening leading up to this pathway. However, it's out of reach for now. Attempting to morph ball bomb jump only destroys the tile below us, dropping us right in the water, so let's remember to come back later. Leaping over a second yapping maw, we make it out of the room and pass through a small tunnel with green and brown mossy clumps and tiny blue foliage with white tips. We're approaching another environment shift as the room itself is unbalanced from left to right, becoming more swollen and moist as we progress further to the right. The next room over is effectively another short tunnel using the same musty terrain, but this time we are seeing it from inside of a large glass tube. It's clear that outside of the tube, this pocket of the cave system is underwater. It's important to notice that there are platforms on the outside, meaning that at one point we must be able to reach this place. Pulling up our map reveals that this is indeed a new area called Meridia, but that's all we know. Moving on, we reach yet another sunken tunnel similar to the first, but on the right, this one lets out into a purple metallic plated doorframe, which finally leads us to another elevator room. But we've been taught not to take anything at face value, and this just happens to be the only elevator room where neurotic morphball bombing rewards our tendencies on the right side by revealing super missile blocks. Ignoring the elevator for now, let's check out this hidden corridor. We drop into a dark blue cavern with purple circuitry in the background. Something is dripping from the blocks above, possibly seeping in from the large body of water above us that we just saw through the glass tube. Moving to the right, we are unable to progress without bomb jumping to reach a ledge that is just out of reach. Even though we can't get to it, there's something resembling a huge drooling mouth carved into the blue stonework above. Whatever's up there is important. But we've been seeing quite a lot of high ledges lately, so let's head back to that elevator in hopes of finding the tool we need to progress. With no other choice, we descend downward. The condensation on our visor quickly evaporates as the temperature rises. Leaving behind the sopping wet marshland of Brinstar, we peek ahead into the deep, rocky, molten caverns of Norfair. A creepy, rhythmic drumbeat leaves us with an unsettling chill. Something feels like we really shouldn't be here. The cave walls are jagged and rocky. The area feels lit by its own radiated heat, fading to complete darkness in the distance. Dropping down to our first set of doors, we find a new enemy crawling around the platforms like a gamer, but these three-eyed flaming insects are called Sovas. The original game's manual claims that these particular critters are coated with a spiky fireproof wool and are frequently found near extreme heat, so they aren't literally on fire. Functionally, they're slightly faster and beefier gamers, and thankfully they are more flavorful than just a simple palette swap. Anyway, we have a green door on our left that we can't progress through far without being immediately blocked by another steel blockade, lowering just before we could make it past, even if we ran. If we instead try the blue door opposite it, then we're in for a horrible surprise. Immediately, we start taking damage due to extreme heat and have to make a quick escape. There doesn't appear to be any way out of that rocky enclosed room at first glance anyway, so we drop down the main shaft in hopes of finding a room we can explore. Instead, we pass another yellow door we can't open, and at the bottom of the room, we have a red door on our left and a blue door on our right. However, a sofa beneath our feet indicates that we can bomb through the floor as a third option. Giving it a try opens up to a third path below, leading to another blue door, but entering it also leads us right into another hot room locked off from progressing, taunting us with a missile expansion we can't reach on the other side of a green button barricade. Retreating before we melt, we try the other blue door just above us. Thankfully, it is a long-awaited save room. And luckily enough, there's a blue door to our right here as well, but upon taking it, we find ourselves in a long hallway that eventually dead ends in front of a bunch of B-toms. Destroying them and bombing the wall shows that we need another power-up to break through, if the other B-toms past the barricade weren't enough of a clue. Well, Norfair hasn't been treating us too kindly so far, but we have one last door to try, the red door across from the save room. Busting it open, we're lucky to find ourselves in front of another energy tank. Considering how some of the energy tank placements in the games before were downright cruel at times, these being out in the open is a real treat. Now, by either bombing the floor in front of it or stepping on the pitfall blocks behind it, we trip into a narrow tunnel just small enough for us to squeeze through. It drops us down a long shaft and leads us to a new blue door, which luckily takes us to a Chozo statue, but it's locked behind a wall. Not giving up, we could try bombing the floor, but that won't get us anywhere. Instead, we shoot the wall, and at the top, it will fizzle away, providing enough of an opening for us to jump over the wall and claim the upgrade. Shooting the orb, we can now claim the high jump boots. Just like with the morph ball, we already know several places where this will be useful. As the name states, the high jump boots will increase our jumping height, making escaping this room that we inadvertently trapped ourselves in escapable. Probably should have thought of that before leaping into what might have been a trap. Luckily, the designers thought of that, and by backtracking out of the room, we are given tall platforms to demonstrate the utility of this new upgrade. And by making it to the top, we are rewarded with a missile expansion. From here, we can bomb our way back out of the room, but the door is locked. Technically, we have run into this before, but this is the first point where most players realize it's happening. This is a metal door, and it won't unlock until all enemies in the room have been eliminated. How the door is aware of this is anybody's guess. Maybe it's powered by Aeon from Dread and Samus Returns or something. Who knows? Anyway, there's actually a particularly speedy Sova in here to help make noticing him easier and hitting him harder. Squashing the bug opens the lock, allowing us to scale the rocky cliffs back up to the elevator. Even with these new boots, there is nothing else we can do in Norfair without some proper heat-resistant equipment. So let's backtrack to Brinstar and try out our new boots. Unfortunately, several of the high ledges we found were before the long drop past the Rippers, and our new boots aren't that powerful. powerful to launch us all the way back up. Instead, let's return to that room with the yapping maws and once again try jumping up that destructible left side. We can now reach a tiny ledge, allowing us to jump again to reach another. Bombing our way through, we might fall into a terrible trap. If we drop a bomb on the second block and aren't holding right, we will accidentally blow a hole in the floor, dropping us through a hidden shaft and right into the yapping maw's spiky underwater lair. Talk about sneaky! Avoiding the trap, we roll to the right and find we've made it to the green door we spotted from below the metal grating. Inside, we find another Chozo statue in a metal chamber. Collecting its upgrade reveals it as the Spazer Beam. This is an optional upgrade that splits our beam into three smaller shots that fire with a much wider range, and effectively doubles our beam's firepower. It's also got an outrageously 90s sci-fi name, and I love it. Shame on Dread for calling it the Wide Beam, even though that makes infinitely more sense. Anyway, let's make good use of our shiny new spacer and high jump boots by returning to the hidden blue room past the elevator. We can now reach the platform where a huge carved statue of a grotesque devil lizard monster sits, covered in claws, horns, and eyeballs all over its body. Stepping through its mouth, we pass through a hidden tunnel and approach a blue door at the end. Inside, we find ourselves in a dilapidated facility, where two Zila accompany us in a claustrophobic space. Taking them out, we can spy a third below the girder under our feet. Bombing reveals a weak spot in the structure, allowing us to continue downward. This place seems far more mechanical than anything we've seen on Zebes yet, but it's rusted and badly in need of repair. At the bottom, we see a locked gray door and nowhere else to go, so we make our own way by bombing to the right, revealing a hidden tunnel, which brings us to a blue door on the ceiling. Emerging topside, the facility seems to have vines growing through the cracks in the foundation, and the red industrial swamp can be seen past it in the distance. But there's no time for that, we're being swarmed by Kai Hunters. Remember, these space pirate allies also guarded the entrance to the spore spawn, so we know we're getting close to another important place for the pirates by their proximity. This is a great place to demonstrate the power of our new spacer beam. That is, if we were even lucky enough to find it. It was an optional upgrade, after all, in an easily missable location. Progressing through the room, we can see large cracks in the floor, as well as giant thorny vines clutching the structure with great force, as if it could start to crumble at any moment. Bombing the far right notch in the floor leads us through a hidden tunnel into a blue door, behind which we find a welcome save station. Unfortunately, that's all that's here. Returning to the vine-entangled room, we try bombing the largest crack in the floor, which gives way and drops us into a small enclosure with another blue door. Inside, we're immediately attacked by a green space pirate, who fortunately takes damage from our new spacer beam. After dealing with him, we've gotta talk about this room. This is a very long corridor, as we will soon see its full scope, but its architecture is bizarre. The background is a mesh of everything we've seen in Brinstar, all contorted into one. Metal crossbeams are supported by clay bricks, while tendrils of thorny red vines support the structure like thick cables. In the foreground is a blaring green, shiny metal series of blocks, which themselves are supported by hexagonal honeycombs of the same substance. This entire room is a disturbing combination of the biological and the synthetic. It feels like we just stumbled into another civilization's advanced form of architecture that's equally barbaric as it is complex and beyond our understanding. The music has also become an uncomfortable beat with a suspenseful tempo, building up what is to come. And we're not even at the best part of this room. I should add a bit of context before we move on. In Metroid 1, when we explored the depths of Brinstar, we uncovered Kraid's lair. While there, we started by entering a similar menacing blue mouth, and eventually passed an eerie room guarding Kraid where the very architecture resembled a huge green face, with glowing red eyes and 12 horrible teeth hanging from the ceiling. Then the actual fight with Kraid was a nightmare. He constantly fired spikes from his chest and nails from his arms, making the fight feel more like a bullet hell survival than a boss arena. Back in Super Metroid, as we traverse this unsettling hallway and dispose of another pirate, spikes start flying our way that we must avoid, as we rush to gain ground against this constant flow of projectiles we pass under a horrifying sight. The very same red-eyed, 12-fanged face in the ceiling. By this point, we know exactly what we're rushing toward, and it's terrifying. This was one of the big two bosses of Metroid 1 before taking on Mother Brain. Kraid is at the end of this this hall, and he's able to fire at us from way off-screen like Bowser shooting fire across the castle stages of Super Mario Brothers. Retaining our composure and gaining ground, we finally reach Kraid. Dodging his attacks and firing off several shots of our own, he explodes surprisingly soon, dropping a fair amount of pickups. Something's wrong. That was way too easy. There wasn't even a music change for the boss fight, if you can even call it that. The metal door behind Kraid unlocks, and we enter into an extension of the Morbid facility, where maroon fleshy tendrils contort and form a sickening organic facade. Immediately, we should be suspicious of the isolated tiles above us, and by shooting them, we can climb the green blocks to reach a green door, behind which lies a recharge room for both our energy and our missiles. Restocking, we return to the room below to find a Zeb pipe, and the room itself changes as we move to the right. Large silver fangs protrude from the ceiling and floor, eventually leading us to a metal platform with a strange corpse covered in green insects that skitter away as we approach, revealing a slumped over figure wearing silver armor not too dissimilar from Samus's own power suit. A sticky yellow substance leaks from the body and coagulates in the corner in which it lays. This is not just the only instance of a corpse we will discover on Zebes, but it's also the only place in the game where these bugs will return to once we leave and come back. Whoever or whatever this body is, we were meant to notice it. Treating the room like a crime scene, just past the corpse is a hideous, thorny gray amoebous glob covering the entire nearby door. This odd fusion of biological and mechanical structures is walling off the passage to the right. This creature is called a Ghidorah, and will only open its singular eye to fire hunks of yellow plasma our way in hopes of having us permanently join the corpse below. That is, assuming this person was killed by the door itself, if we take the yellow slime as evidence. Because honestly, I'm not entirely convinced. Just looking at the base level evidence that we had access to at the time of this game's release, all we can assume is that this was some sort of adventurer who met their untimely end here in the depths of Brinstar, based on the references implied by the Super Metroid Player's Guide, which claims many explorers have met horrific ends due to their untimely run-ins with space pirates. Considering this is the only body we discover on Zebes, this is likely what the Player's Guide was referencing. However, it's not exactly a satisfying conclusion. How is it that some single, random adventurer was not only able to safely discover and navigate this planet, but to also make it all the way here to the core of the space pirate headquarters on their own, only to be killed by a door? If this really is just an adventure-seeking explorer, they would have turned back at the first sign of space pirate activity, not pursued them all the way to their boss. How many space pirates would this supposed explorer have killed or snuck past in order to simply reach this point? Considering how unlikely this is, fans underwent an in-depth analysis of this scene in hopes of shedding light on this mystery, going so far as to investigate various types of blood bases like vanadium or iridium that would give off this sticky yellow hue and imply if this body is something other than human, now assuming that the dripping substance from the body is its own blood. This is a natural conclusion to make, as sea cucumbers do have this yellow blood, but this only implies that the corpse is actually an unknown alien species, intelligent enough to fashion its own armor. You think this is getting too deep? Well, I'm not even at the craziest theory yet. Let's fast forward all the way to Metroid Prime Hunters for the DS, where several other bounty hunter characters are introduced, all of different races from across space. One of these hunters is Weevil, who sports an almost identical metallic armor suit that the corpse wears, even down to the details. It's even more similar than the Galactic Federation trooper uniforms we will also see in the Prime series. But who is Weevil? Weevil was a space pirate before he had an unfortunate run-in with Samus in Brinstar, which left him mortally wounded. But we didn't kill this person, or whatever it is, did we? How do we know that this wasn't one of the space pirates we've already encountered on our journey so far? Because Weevil wasn't always wearing this suit. It was only after his near-death experience that surviving space pirates would recover his body, remove his brain and spinal cord, and transplant them into a biological cyborg armor suit that we now recognize. One important thing to note about this corpse: Its head appears to be completely impaled, almost as if it were carved open to have its entire brain and spinal cord extracted. But hold up a moment, we're getting our timeline mixed up. Prime Hunters happens between Metroid 1 and 2, meaning that Weevil would have already been defeated and reborn by this point. You could say that Samus never encountered Weevil or any other space pirates in Brinstar and Metroid 1, and you'd be right. However, it's been heavily implied by the developers that given the chance to remake Metroid 1 again, Weevil would likely appear and be given a larger role than before. Could this mean that Weevil's unfortunate run-in with Samus is retroactively assumed to be canon in Metroid 1? Therefore, we can assume that this is the remains of Weevil's damaged suit from Prime Hunters, returned to the Space Pirate headquarters in Brinstar, where his brain and spinal cord are removed once again, implying that he has survived yet another near-death experience and is currently being revived by the space pirates elsewhere in the facility. That would mean that all of our theories are correct. This was a powerful space warrior who wasn't human and bled yellow, likely from some sort of synthetic material used to support his vital systems. He made it this far because he didn't have to sneak past the pirates. He was one of them! So anyway, there's this dead guy on the floor, and Samus moves to take out the Ghidorah, blocking the room on the right. The best way to take these threats down is by being brave and standing right in their face, and firing a missile each time they open their eye before they have a chance to fire off a glob of plasma. Entering the next room, the door locks behind us, and we're trapped in a very small ledge, overlooking what appears to be endless spiky thorns on the floor. The walls are thick knots of thorny vines, and the low ceiling blocks us into this enclosed space. But we're not alone. The ground begins to rumble. Dust and pollen disperse as boulders fly through the air. A huge, green, monstrous, three-eyed lizard head emerges from the thicket, and slowly as the room shakes, we realize that this is Kraid. Space pirates rule by a world of survival of the fittest, and only the biggest and strongest among them can be fit to command. Judging by our last encounter with Kraid on the NES, he's grown tremendously in size, enough to fool us with what we now know was just Mini Kraid. Technically, there was a Mini Kraid in Brinstar in Metroid 1 as well, and its purpose was exactly the same here, to try and fool any would-be attackers from believing they defeated Kraid and mistakenly retreat without defeating the real Space Pirate Commander. However, in Metroid 1, Mini Kraid and Kraid both share the same scale and just swap color palettes. In Super, Mini Kraid looks just like the Kraid on the box art, except this time the trick was his scale. We had no idea he'd be this massive. Players who instead experienced Metroid Zero Mission, the Game Boy Advance remake of Metroid 1, wouldn't have been fooled by Mini Kraid, as Kraid was recreated in that game to be just as colossal as he stands in front of us right now in Super. The music has also shifted into a new boss theme, an unsettling, low-pitched horn intimidating us by its uncomfortable tempo alone. Back to the fight, Kraid is now completely invincible, fitting for the space pirate leader. He does, however, have one weakness. When Kraid roars, he exposes the inside of his mouth, which is painfully vulnerable to missiles. Though he attempts to wave his arms about blocking our shots, we can force him to let out a bellow by landing a missile right on his eyes. It's important to do this anticipating when his claws will be in the way, so we don't get blocked while shooting as many missiles as we can into his mouth. Once we damage Kraid for the first time, the room rumbles again as the gargantuan beast rises up from the ground below, crushing the ceiling as it fully stands up. The ceiling has now become a couple floating platforms for us to leap between in order to damage Kraid as he backs into a corner. Falling down means landing in the thorny thicket, so we need to avoid that at all costs. Aside from trying to knock us into the pit, Kraid will be firing multiple projectiles at us, just like in his original battle. The first type are huge spikes that launch out of his dotted line of belly button-like holes down his front side. These are just large enough for us to stand on in desperation if the need arises. The second type are boomerang-esque claws that sail from one end of the room to the other, sweeping us from unexpected directions. Up on these platforms, we can fully register just how enormous this colossus is. Kraid is towering over us, even as we stand on what used to be the ceiling of this room. Shooting Kraid in one of the exposed holes on his belly will also make him roar in pain, though more likely out of irritation, as he only takes damage directly in the mouth. In the event that we run out of missiles, we can always charge our beam or destroy the smaller projectiles in hopes of getting some missiles back. Though he doesn't have a lot of HP, discovering and exploiting this weak spot can be tricky, but with enough tenacity, the Green Titan will let out a final cry in agony, slowly exploding and flailing its arms as it collapses through the floor, taking the remaining platforms and bramble with it, leaving behind a wealth of restoration pickups. Before we move on from this incredible boss, I should also mention that Kraid can be defeated before he ever fully stands up. If Kraid is struck in the face at the right time and roars, we can just barely fire off 4 well-placed super missiles into his mouth, just enough to defeat the boss before the fight has even begun. With the mighty Kraid defeated one way or another, we can now traverse this huge room once filled with dangerous thorns and enter the room at the far end. We know we're in for something great as the boss music has faded into the item room jingle. Inside the small enclosed mechanical room is a pedestal with an item orb, possibly confiscated by the space pirates from a Chozo statue. Shooting and collecting it reveals it to be the Various Suit. It was wise of the pirates to hoard such an important upgrade from Samus, as we will see momentarily. Samus faces forward and the entire screen flashes in a glowing bright beam of light. Once the light dims, we can bask in the glory of the upgrade we just acquired. Few upgrades actually make you feel more powerful than Samus's suits, as we have actively changed our outward appearance for the rest of the game. Notably, Samus's shoulder pads have swollen to large spheres with 2 protruding crescent blades each. The entire suit also appears much more durable with a darker orange motif. Mechanically, the Varia suit historically halves damage taken, as Varia is actually a mistranslation of the word barrier. Though it would be properly translated in Metroid 2's game manual, the game itself still makes this mistake, as does Metroid 1. At this rate, it's a charming accident that resulted in this unique word defining Samus's iconic suit design. Strangely enough, advertising media, fan art, or otherwise crossover representation of Samus will almost assuredly always depict her in this suit, ironically her mid-game suit. The Super Smash Bros. Series, for instance, has used Samus's Varia suit design for every single installment, as does virtually all of Metroid's cover art and posters, with only rare exceptions like Fusion and Dread. But aside from looking and feeling more powerful, the Varia suit in Super Metroid also grants us a special ability aside from damage reduction. We can now fully explore the sweltering caverns of Norfair by completely negating heat damage. Samus must have packed AC units into those massive shoulder pads or something to keep cool. That suit's probably grossly sweaty as it is, especially after an athletic, high-strung boss fight. This is science way beyond our understanding, so hopefully the Chozo thought about Samus's health when designing or suits. Anyway, heading back through Kraid's lair, we backtrack our way past the corpse-munching insects and reach the long corridor, discovering that Mini Kraid has respawned, as well as the space pirates. But we're literally twice as strong as when we last traveled down this hallway, so we are more than capable of holding our own against them a second time. Shooting our way up and out from the crack in the floor, we once again battle a swarm of Kai Hunters and work our way back toward that locked door we passed when we first entered this hidden place. The door is now flashing, indicating that it was triggered by Kraid's death. Inside, we appear to be ambushed by 4 BTOM in a dead-end trap. Bombing them off, it's interesting to note, these creatures that may very well have been failed engineered attempts by the space pirates to create Metroids were locked together behind a door that only opened once the space pirate leader was slain. Were these creatures being cultivated under Kraid's orders in hopes that they could create a new race of Metroids? Did Ridley's capture of the last living Metroid discourage the space pirates from experimenting with the BTOM any further, and instead cause them to focus solely on cloning a purebred living Metroid? We can only guess as to what happened. But luckily, this room isn't just an empty lore implication. If we shoot the ceiling, we can reveal a hidden energy tank, which we graciously collect and add to our already beefy defense. A coy nod to the hidden energy tank in Kraid's room in the original Metroid for NES. At least this one's not dangling over a lava pit in a tiny morph ball-sized cubby in an already difficult spot to shoot. Anyway, rewarded for our investigation, we can now confidently make our way out of this creepy place, exit through the gaping blue maw, and return to the elevator that will deliver us to Norfair, now fully equipped for the challenge ahead. Keep in mind that we are still trapped down here. Even if we were to attempt backtracking, we'd be stopped by the impossibly tall shaft filled with rippers, and even before that, a barrier locked us on this side of the map. We've had quite the journey through this subterranean jungle maze. Brinstar proved prove to be a massively overgrown biological nightmare devised by space pirates. The parasitic infestation of bizarre wildlife has overtaken and engorged the mechanical structures that used to define this place. Now, Brinstar is a living swamp with dangerous creatures coming out of the walls, on top of the horrific experimental bioweapons. Some of its traps we fell right into, but when met with dead ends, we made our own path forward. We stormed the hidden space pirate facility and defeated their commander. Armed with new armor and dangerous weapons, we feel empowered by our own discoveries. But are we strong enough to survive the intense flames of Norfair? With no other choice, Samus descends once again into the depths of the planet's molten underground, unaware of what traps or abominations may be lying in wait in the blazing caverns below. And that's a wrap for Chapter 3 of the Super Metroid Experience. This one was much longer than the others, but I wanted to make sure that I covered Brinstar's story in full. We will be returning here later, getting a lot of the pickups and learning about places that we could not reach previously. And I'm looking forward to doing that, but next time we are really going to be focusing on Norfair and everything that is going to get us out of our current predicament and let us explore the greater map. And I'm very excited to do that. There are some more things I do want to talk about very briefly here at the end of this in closing. First of all, there is an enemy, I'm not going to reveal which, that I actually lied to you about the name of, and that will be clear in an upcoming chapter later, similar to how Kraid was I was lying to you as well about Kraid and Mini Kraid. That will be clear at a later point. Also, this, if you couldn't tell, was the longest chapter by far that we've done so far for this, and because of that, it was really pushing my computer to its limits. I waited 30 minutes just to sit here and record this little post audio with you, and I want to make sure that if I do this in the future, that it's not going to be as taxing, so I'm going to learn from this experience. But I'm very excited to have this done so I can share this with you all. We're finally getting to explore the meat of the game, and I am having so much fun, and I'm actually learning a lot of stuff about the game as I am hyper-analyzing it and transforming it all into a story and an experience for you guys. So hopefully you are enjoying it just as much as I am. But thank you all so much for joining me, and I will see you in Chapter 4 of the Super Metroid Experience.